Good morning, everyone. We're just going to give things a few minutes here before we get started, just to ensure everybody is able to join us in a timely fashion before we get our program started. Okay, great. Most of you have been able to join us for today's webinar. My name is Eric Searing. I'm the Director of External Relations here at the Wisconsin Institute for Law and Liberty. I want to wish you all a happy School Choice Week, and thank you all for joining us for today's presentation. Just a quick housekeeping item. WIL is a nonprofit law and policy center here in Milwaukee. We are able to do what we are able to do thanks to the generosity of our supporters and donors. And we want to thank you all for joining us this morning for this morning's webinar. And it gives me it's my pleasure to turn it over here to my colleague, Dr. Will Flanders, and our associate counsel, Cory Brewer.
Thanks, Eric. So as Eric mentioned, we're celebrating School Choice Week here. And we thought that'd be a good time to put out our sort of annual apples to apples report that we'll be discussing in the first portion of this webinar. I will say, if folks have questions as we go along, we'll try to take a look as we go along, though we may end up with answering them more at the end. But please feel free to post things into the chat as they come up for you. So we'll just begin with a brief overview of how does school choice in Wisconsin look today. Wisconsin has a wide variety of educational options, and some of them may not immediately come to mind when you think of the term school choice, but they are all forms of school choice. We'll begin with our three parental choice programs or four parental choice programs in the state. The first being the Milwaukee Parental Choice Program. And apologize for those of you that this might be review, but we sort of have a wide variety of folks with different levels of experience on the call. So we'll go over this briefly. But the Milwaukee Parental Choice Program is the oldest voucher program in the country. It began in 1990 with a coalition of Democrats and Republicans, not something we often always see today. But the program has grown over time to serve more than 27,000 students. Next, we have the Racine Parental Choice Program. This program serves more than 3,000 students, obviously in the Racine Unified School District area. And that program began in the previous decade in the 2010s. Perhaps the most intriguing and fastest growing parental choice program in the state is the statewide parental choice program. This program covers every part of the state outside of Milwaukee and Racine, and it's grown to more than 16,000 participants as of the most recent data from DPI. The final private school choice program we'll mention is the special needs scholarship program. This allows students with disabilities to receive a larger voucher so that private schools are better able to meet their needs. And unlike our other choice programs that we've gone over, this one does not have any income restrictions or things of that nature that sort of restrict access. Another kind of school choice that's very important in Wisconsin are charter schools. Charter schools are authorized by a number of different entities throughout the state, including school districts, as well as the UW system. And more than 50,000 students in Wisconsin utilize charter schools of the district or independent variety. Independents are the ones that are run by entities other than school districts. And finally, we'll mention open enrollment. This is the one that I think a lot of folks don't conceptualize as being school choice, but it nonetheless fits under the umbrella of school choice. And it's actually our state's largest school choice program. More than 70,000 students use this program to move from one public school district into another one, using the most recent data that was available from DPI on open enrollment usage. This chart just shows the enrollment in different school choice programs over time, focused here on the private school choice programs. The blue line is the Milwaukee Parental Choice Program, and you can see since 2001, with just over 10,000 students, we've grown to more than 27,000 students as of today. And you can see the other parental choice programs, the WPCP, the RPCP, and the Special Needs Scholarship coming along in the next decade. And the rapid growth, as we noted on the previous slide, in the WPCP from under, I think, 499 participants in the first year in 2013 to more than 16,000 participants as of today. So one of the foci of this presentation is the benefits that have been found for school choice in Wisconsin over time. And it's important to note that this isn't just a phenomenon that's been, you know, found by Will, the organization. There's been a lot of research over the years, particularly into the Milwaukee Parental Choice Program. As we noted on the previous slide, it's the, or in an earlier slide, it is the oldest private voucher program in the country. And because it was a new experiment, because it was a new idea, it was the focus for a good deal of research. And the state actually funded the school choice demonstration project, which was run by researchers out of the University of Arkansas. And they conducted a really lengthy study of over a decade, comparing the outcomes for students who participated in the Milwaukee Parental Choice Program with the outcomes for similar students who were in the traditional public schools in Milwaukee. And some of the findings from that research include a higher graduation rates from high school. So students in the choice program were more likely to graduate from high school. Greater entrance and persistence in college. So students from choice programs are more likely to both go to college and to persist and eventually graduate. The next one is lower involvement in criminal activity. And this is one of the more interesting studies that that came out of the school choice demonstration project. Some of you may be familiar with Cory DeAngelis, who is at American Federation for Children. I put on the right-hand side of the screen here sort of the abstract from one of his papers that looked into this. And they found that students who participated in choice were actually less likely to become involved in criminal activity. In another paper from DeAngelis, they also found they're less likely to become involved in paternity lawsuits, which they argue is sort of an argument that these schools might be better at promoting morality and moral conduct than other forms of schools. But despite this strong evidence, critics have continued to claim that there aren't really any benefits of school choice. We'd like to think the case has at least been somewhat settled based on the data, but that doesn't appear to be the case, at least in the minds of some critics. And that's why we continue to do our apples to apples report on an annual basis. So what do we do in our apples to apples report? Well, we try to move beyond the sort of superficial data points that are made available from DPI to take a deeper dive and put schools on what we call a level playing field. So in order to do that, we have to recognize the students that schools deal with and the different challenges that come with educating students. So some of the key factors in our analysis include student race, student economic status, as well obviously as grade level, because performance tends to vary by grade level. Some might wonder why student race has to be a component of this. And the reality is what you see on the right-hand side of the screen here. These are the results over time from the NAEP, which is a nationally norm reference test that's taken by students all over the country. And continually on that measure, at least regularly over time, Wisconsin shows up as having the worst racial achievement gaps in the country. What you see particularly in this chart is the NAEP scores for white students are in the circle. The NAEP scores for African-American students are in the plus sign. And you can see that the gap was large in 1992, but in 2022, that gap was even larger in both math in grade four and grade eight. It's a similar story if you look at other subsets like English language arts or other subjects on the NAEP as well. So unfortunately, student race remains an important factor we must consider in doing a fair analysis. Student economic status is also a big factor. One outcome of our study that's pretty regularly shown over time is that if you had a school with 100% low-income students and a school with zero low-income students, the expected proficiency gap, the difference in the number of students that are proficient on the forward exam, would be expected to be more than 40% different. So it's a huge shift based on both student race and economic status, and they're not mutually exclusive. You put both variables into the model and both tend to show up as significant. We'll begin with just a sort of look at the at proficiency over time in the state of Wisconsin. And what you can see is that even back in 2015, proficiency rates weren't extremely high. This is all of the years that we've been taking the current forward exam test. Proficiency rates in 2015 were in the mid 40s. So that means the majority of students were not ranked as proficient in either math or ELA. But you can see this pretty precipitous decline between 2018 and 2020. You'll note that 2019 is absent from this chart. That's because we didn't have a state exam in 2019-20 school year due to COVID. But when students came back and took the exam next year, there was a significant decline in proficiency, dropping from above 40% to below 40% for the first time in the states, at least in the era of the forward exam. And we saw a little bit of a rebound in math. Proficiency rates rose back above 40%, but are still significantly lower than where they were pre-pandemic. But in ELA, we actually saw an even further decline in 2021. I think it's important to note that this chart might look slightly different than what you see on the DPI website. That's because we've excluded students who didn't take the test. The number of students who didn't take the test was extremely high in 2020. And that led to really sort of low proficiency numbers. They're actually unfairly deflated. And if you don't account for those students, you'll actually see a big increase this year. But we think it's fair to exclude those students in both years so we can see a cleaner picture of what's happening with proficiency. But regardless, proficiency rates have not fully rebounded even using the straight DPI metrics. So what we have here are some of the main findings from our apples to apples report. This is looking at the difference in each of these sectors from the proficiency rates in traditional public schools after accounting for all of those factors and some other ones that we mentioned in the earlier slide. And what we see for private choice is we see a significant proficiency advantage of nearly 8%. Of more than 8% in both math and ELA. We have two types of charters here. We won't go into a ton of depth on the differences between these charter schools, but suffice it to say district charters are those that are under the authorization of the school district. Independent charters are those authorized by the city of Milwaukee, UW-Milwaukee, and others. In both sets of charter schools, we see a significant proficiency advantage of more than 8% in district charters and more than 4% in independent charters. I think it's important to note that though you do see differences between each of these bars, the differences, for example, between private choice and district charters probably are not statistically significant. They're close enough that there isn't going to be a significant enough gap to measure there. What about when we look statewide? Well, statewide, we see again a performance advantage for private school choice of about 2% in math and about 3.5% or 3.25% in ELA. For district charters, we see a performance advantage for ELA, though we did not find a significant performance advantage in math. I think one thing that's important to note for district charters when we look statewide is that a lot of virtual schools are included in the district charter count. And while those schools can be a great benefit to some folks, they do tend to have lower proficiency overall, and that can sort of be a drag on the district charter sector. For independent charters, we did not find a performance advantage. I think the key thing to note here is that outside of Milwaukee, there are very few district charters in the state right now. Some of you may be familiar with the issues that have happened with the OEO, which is one of the key authorizers for independent charters outside of Milwaukee. And the questions about the likelihood that will be a viable charter authorizer. So independent charters, there are not a lot of them, and there aren't a lot of independent charters that we hope that we can continue to see that grow in the future. And that'll allow us to better assess the performance of those schools going forward. A few other things we try to look at in our apples to apples report are what difference does school funding make in student performance? Obviously, we heard from the governor last night that there's gonna be proposals for significant increases in spending per student. What you see on this chart, it might look fairly complicated, but each red dot represents a school in the state of Wisconsin. And what we're comparing it to here is proficiency based on spending per student. So you see we range from over $10,000 to just under $30,000 per student. And the line is very flat. The main outcome we're conveying here is that there's very little relationship between how much money we spend in Wisconsin and student outcomes. The implications for that are not that spending never matters. Obviously, if we were at $0 per student, we'd have a very hard time running a school. But what this means is that we're probably past the point of diminishing returns for many public schools around the state. And I think one thing to note is that we are at a time of massive inflation, and this may vary in the future, and there may well be some argument for some additional level of spending. But the moral of the story here, and the key argument is that spending is not the only answer. And if there is going to be additional spending, it ought to be targeted rather than just throwing more money at schools when additional spending really doesn't appear to make much difference. And by the way, even if you remove those schools at the very end of the line at $30,000 per kid, it still will look like a very flat line. So those outliers don't really change outcomes. And it looks very similar for ELA. What we're showing here is math. One other finding to mention is that Wisconsin's rural schools often struggle nearly as much as our urban schools. And I think one important thing to note as we look at this slide is that we're not just talking about Milwaukee here. If we compare rural schools to Milwaukee, obviously rural schools tend to have a proficiency advantage, but we're taking census-defined urban districts and comparing rural, suburban, and small town districts to them. And what you see is that compared to all the urban districts in the state, rural schools actually have lower proficiency in ELA and in math to a statistically significant level. Rural schools have about 4% lower proficiency in ELA and a little over 2% in math. Our suburban schools do enjoy a performance advantage over urban schools, perhaps like folks would expect, but not to a huge extent. We're just under 2% for math and just over 2% for English language arts. Small town districts, we also see a performance deficit of about 2% in ELA and no difference from urban schools in math. So when we think about the need for educational options and we think about the need for improving education around the state, I think it's important to note this isn't just an urban problem. This is a problem throughout the state where schools, particularly in rural areas, are struggling. So we've talked about some of the advantages and of school choice. There are other ones as well that we obviously haven't been able to fully get into in this report. But there are also a lot of barriers that are in the way of school choice. Cory Brewer, my colleague, is going to focus on a few of them, but just a few other ones to mention first. The biggest impediment is income limits. So the income limits on the parental choice programs in the state are 300% of the federal poverty limit for Milwaukee and 220% of the federal poverty limit for the statewide program. What you can see on the right-hand side of the screen here are the income limits by family size. That's taken straight from DPI's website. And for a family of four making $61,000 a year, you're already over the eligibility limit for the statewide program. You talk to a family of four, particularly with the large inflation we've been going through that makes that level of income. And obviously they're in most cases not gonna be able to afford private school choice. So that's a big impediment to the program. We sort of squeeze middle-class families out of educational choice, and the organization will. We are big advocates for, in the end, removing those enrollment caps, those income limits and allowing more families to access educational options. Next one I'll mention is the funding gap. Our choice and charter schools in Wisconsin have thousands of dollars less per student than do our traditional public schools. The amount varies, but the average public school in the state, just looking at state and local funding, is now over $14,000 per student. Our voucher program is under $9,000, and our charter schools are just over $9,000. So we're looking at a funding gap of nearly $5,000 per student. There is some benefit in maintaining a, the reality these schools do more with less, but we think at the rate that that schools are underfunded at this point, there's a risk of schools losing the program, and some of the better schools are really struggling right now, particularly in light of inflation. And we've already lost one of our high schools in the Milwaukee Parental Choice Program, pretty clearly due to the funding gap. We also have enrollment caps that are gradually coming off, and I'll turn it over to my colleague Cory Brewer to go over some of the stuff.
Well, good morning, everyone, and thank you, Will, and thank you for joining us, everyone, this morning. I'll talk a little bit about a few more barriers to school choice, which will lead us into the kind of second part of the presentation related to our ongoing lawsuit. So another thing we have listed here, restrictive enrollment period. What does that mean? Families applying to send their student to participate in the Wisconsin or statewide parental choice program are only able to enroll from February 1st until mid-April. So as you can imagine, a lot of families don't even begin to think about where they're going to send their child in the fall until at least summertime. If a family moves to Wisconsin in May or June or over the summer, if maybe a child is struggling in a local public school, they don't decide until after the school year is over that they would like to take another route, they're not able to do so if they miss that February to mid-April enrollment window. And then, you add to this grade level entry points. So in the Racine and statewide choice programs, students are only eligible to enroll if they're entering K-4, K-5, first grade, or ninth grade. So if a family misses that enrollment window for their child during first grade, he or she won't be eligible for a seat in the choice program again until ninth grade. And on top of the barriers that we've each kind of discussed, there's just these kind of more regulatory requirements, bureaucratic red tape. And that leads me to kind of our second piece here. Last year, Will became aware of a rule that DPI was implementing and enforcing that was effectively keeping families out of the choice program. These are eligible families that the program was designed to serve, and our state government, unfortunately, was creating barriers for families to access the program. So in the lawsuit that you can kind of see on your screen here, we filed suit on behalf of School Choice Wisconsin Action, Catholic Memorial High School, and Roncalli Catholic Schools against the Department of Public Instruction. I won't get too into the weeds on the legal claims here, but it is an administrative rulemaking lawsuit filed under Chapter 227 and essentially challenges these rules DPI enforced that were not promulgated in compliance with the statutory rulemaking procedures or that exceed DPI's authority under state law. So what the lawsuit does is it challenges an application perfection rule for various school choice programs. And I had mentioned that this was brought to our attention last year. So what was occurring is that families applying for the choice program, they need to submit a document to verify their residency. It's really common for families to submit a utility bill for this residency verification. And in Wisconsin Rapids, the utility company was filling out addresses on the utility bill as WISC Rapids. So it was WISC Rapids. And these families learned that if they did not correct that because the word Wisconsin was not spelled out, they would need to make a correction or be ineligible for the choice program. So this is kind of the example that first put this on our radar. We did a little bit more research and found that there was kind of a broader application perfection requirement that DPI was enforcing. And I have some examples up here on the screen. Our lawsuit involves challenges to name verification, address verification, and also what residency documents can be used. As you can see on the bottom of the screen here, I've listed some documents that DPI has considered to be unacceptable to prove residency. So if a family provides an internet services bill, a bank statement, a rent receipt, those are not eligible documents. They're not acceptable to verify residency when you're applying to the choice program. A few other examples, one that we've been hearing, and we've been discussing this with a lot of schools, a really common issue is a name issue, and it could obviously apply to anyone, but it's most common in the Hispanic tradition. So if a mom enrolling her kid in the choice program, if her name is, for example, Maria Garcia Garcia, so her last name is Garcia, she got married, her spouse's name was also last name Garcia. She uses that name on the online application system when trying to sign up her child for the choice program, but maybe her utility bill that she uses for a residency document only says Maria Garcia. It doesn't include both last names. Well, currently that is not a perfect match. It would render the application ineligible and require a correction. Thankfully, a lot of these families are able to correct their applications in a way that DPI requires, but schools and families spend so much time and resources navigating these rules, trying to get past this bureaucratic burden that has been put in place. And like I said earlier, done so outside of the bounds of state law. So skipping kind of the public notice and comment rulemaking process required in our state law and just exceeding DPI's authority. So the last thing I'll kind of touch on is what is the effect if a family has one of these mismatches or an imperfection and it's not corrected. Well, ultimately, a child will lose their seat in the program, and oftentimes they don't find out until many months into the school year. So the child loses their seat, and then the school loses the voucher amount that they had to educate that child. So what can happen there? The schools sometimes, if they're able, can try to set up a financial aid situation. They could educate the child for free. Or some schools, they just simply can't afford that. So the child is forced to find another educational option. Again, these are eligible families. These are families the program was designed to serve. A child may be doing really well in school. And, you know, because maybe his dad put Chuck on the application form, but another residency document says Charles, that's not a perfect match. It's an ineligible application. And the child becomes ineligible for the program. And as I had mentioned before, with these grade level entry points, that could mean that they're ineligible for years based on what program they're in. And another reality that we've heard about recently is a lot of families simply give up. This process is really burdensome, and families, it's hard for them to gather paperwork. If there's language barriers, if families are moving around a lot, it's just really, really difficult to navigate. We heard from a school recently that every year she has about 15 or 20 incomplete applications on her desk because families that are eligible for this program, trying to find a high quality education for their children, they simply give up because it's such a hard process to navigate.
Thanks, Cory. And I think I'll take the chance here to just go through a few of the questions that have been brought up in the chat while we've been speaking. Scott Frostman asked, what is the average state aid per student statewide? You know, I think we're at over $8,000 in just state aid. That doesn't include the local component. That's the average across the state. It varies pretty extensively because we have what's known as equalization aid. So districts with low property values tend to get a lot more state aid, and districts with a lot of property value get a lot less. We have districts that are under 1,000 all the way to almost fully funded in districts like Beloit and Milwaukee that are much more heavily weighted towards state funding. And the next question from an anonymous attendee was, what is the MPS per pupil cost? We're at over $15,000 per kid, including federal funding in MPS, $14,000 in state and local funding. In MPS. They're in the top 100 in the state, though not the highest funded district, as some folks might think. We had another question about what is the highest funded district in the state and what outcomes do they get? There's a district called Norris, which we actually exclude from our analysis because it's focused on students with different needs, that gets over $30,000 per kid. We leave that district out because it's a special case. But other than Norris, what we see are districts that have a lot of vacation homes, but not a lot of students. So districts up on Lake Superior in northern Wisconsin tend to be the highest funded districts in the state because they have a lot of property value and very few kids. On average, their outcomes tend to be about average, you know, sort of like what we see in the rural schools, but maybe a little bit better. And that may, to some extent, drive down the results that we see. I would note that we have a resource on our website. That's the school scorecard. You can find it if you go to will-law.org, and you can pull from a drop-down menu every school district in the state and see the breakdown of funding for that district. I'll note that we're in the process of updating that with the newest data from DPI, and that should happen in the next few weeks here. So Cory and I have both covered some of the impediments to school choice. What we're going to mention now is what we see going forward. What do we think are the opportunities as we celebrate School Choice Week this year to improve school choice in Wisconsin? We'll note that there's a big coalition effort that's supporting improving private school choice in Wisconsin, as well as potentially charter schools as well. The first thing is removing those income limits. Again, that's a huge impediment to middle-class families accessing school choice. The biggest key by far is the next point here, and that's raising the voucher amount. Again, we have schools like Hope Christian High School that have had to close because the voucher amount simply isn't sufficient. And with massive inflation, it's just fundamentally unfair that these schools that educate kids and do a good job are getting thousands of dollars less per student than our public schools. We'd like to see some level of equality reached in that regard. The next is to move away from the property tax implications of school choice. And if anyone's interested in this, I'm happy to, you know, discuss it further with you offline. It's probably a little too detailed to get into on this call. But the idea is to protect the choice program and to, even though in the long run statewide, the choice program is a savings because it's less funding per kid, there are continually arguments about the property tax cost of school choice. We think in the long term, moving away from that would be a benefit, and our coalition groups are sort of supporting that effort. So some conclusions, and again, now would be a good time if you have other questions we haven't addressed yet, feel free to put those in the chat at this time. But you know, Wisconsin is should be proud. We should be proud of our place in the history of school choice around the country. A lot of states have built their model of school choice on what Wisconsin did, but we're sort of falling behind. We saw in Iowa just yesterday the passage of a school choice program that statewide will allow students up to 300% of the federal poverty limit to take advantage of it. We've seen other states potentially surpass Wisconsin with more innovative reforms. So we think it's time for Wisconsin to sort of get ourselves in gear and get ourselves back to a leadership position that we've long enjoyed. That involves removing some of those roadblocks that we've discussed, and that includes making sure that we focus also on rural schools to ensure that students all over the state, not just in our urban areas, have access to a large number of educational options. And with that, we'll just mention here, if you have other questions or want more details, feel free to reach out to either one of us. Focused on the policy side would be questions for me. Focus on the law side for Cory. And yeah, we invite any questions from the audience at this point. We can open that up and see what's come through here. So Kevin asked, do we support an increase in the general public school open enrollment amount, which is currently lower than the voucher amount? I think that is an excellent question. We think that more money should follow the student on the public school side as well. And you're right, the amount that follows the kid in the open enrollment program, I believe is under $7,000. I need to look that one up. It may be approaching $8,000, but we think more money should follow the student. One particular concern when you talk about open enrollment is that we want it to be incentivized for both the donor district and the receiving district so that more districts participate. And so potentially leaving a little bit of a skim could be useful in that instance, though in general, our narrative is that the money should follow the kid, and absolutely it should happen in open enrollment as well. Looking at other questions, has there been any discussion regarding oversight needed of the OEO, maybe legislature oversight from Tara, which would have actual teeth to ensure the OEO properly serves the people of Wisconsin? I think that our general thought process, and Cory, you know, feel free to add to this, is that the ultimate accountability is to parents. And you know, with the OEO system, it represents a new opportunity for students around the state to take advantage of charter education. Those opportunities, as I mentioned, have been extremely limited in the past, but we'd like that program to grow and to have a large number of schools sort of underneath its umbrella. Obviously, with the recent changes, that's potentially concerning. That's not going to be the case, but we think parental accountability is the ultimate accountability, and that is in general sufficient. And then we have a question from Ann Chapman to see apples per pupil spending amounts to compare with the all in district figures you cite. Would it be important to understand how much per pupil do choice schools spend, taking into account all the revenue sources, not just state payments? Do you have that info? So that's a great question. Our argument here is what is essentially the taxpayer cost of these schools, and then that's why we focus on state spending and local spending relative to the voucher amount. But it certainly is the case that the choice schools can get money from other sources. I'd also note that public schools often can get money from other sources as well. We've seen partnerships between local businesses and public schools, and that's obviously not captured by our model either. Let's see. Any other questions?
Jump in here and kind of build off of one of your responses. You had discussed the money following the child. We have an anonymous attendee here that asked, what do the efforts look like to get a universal ESA in Wisconsin, or an education savings account? Are there any plans to get a statewide tax credit scholarship program? So this differs obviously by state. Some states recently have enacted those universal ESAs. In Wisconsin, we're looking kind of at a different approach. Will does support the funds following the child. You may have heard the phrase before, fund students, not systems. It wouldn't likely be an ESA here, but as Dr. Will Flanders, my colleague, had just kind of described on one of these previous slides, we're looking at the kind of GPR or general purpose revenue funding and believe that for all kids to get a, you know, be have parents be able to make the choice, have a high quality education, just to remove those income limits and remove those barriers altogether.
Yeah, that's an excellent point, Cory. I think what we should say is in the long term, education savings accounts are absolutely something that should be looked at. But there's a real concern with the low level of funding that if we create an ESA right now, that choice schools may actually be forced out of the program because, you know, if students can divvy up their resources, schools are already struggling to make it with the funding levels as they are. So we think before we can consider an ESA, not that it shouldn't be considered, it's a very intriguing solution. First, we have to fix some of the funding issues. And at that point, then maybe options like that become more on the table. Molly asked, will Hope Christian School be staying with a different funding source? As far as I'm aware, and you know, anybody who's on our call can tell me if they have other information, I think the school is shut down. Their model was reliance on the voucher. You know, with the question about outside funding sources, that wasn't really Hope's model. Their goal was to rely almost exclusively on the voucher amount for funding. And without that, the high school, as far as I know, is unfortunately going away. One other question I see in here is where might homeschooling fit in? This is an excellent question as well. When folks talk about something like an ESA option in the future, there's really an easy, you know, easy way to imagine how homeschooling fits into that, because the parents could directly receive funding for directly educating their students. In the sort of interim, I think we tend to keep homeschooling as a separate concept, just because a lot of homeschool parents want to be left on their own. They don't want to be involved in the fights that we have in the state legislature, and they sort of like the amount of freedom that they have in Wisconsin. But if we can move to an ESA at some point in the future, I think that would be a good thing. I don't know, Cory, if you see any other questions we missed, or Eric or Kyle, if you guys see something we should address.
I would touch on one of the, I don't know, Kevin, this might not, you know, directly answer your question here, but you had asked about kind of family involvement, parents taking advantage of voucher opportunities, parents that maybe don't consider the best options for their children. Obviously, we would hope that they do. I think the vast, vast majority of them do. But Will also has, I'll just take a moment to point out, we have a project called Restoring American Education. You know, 4 out of 5 kids in our state currently do attend their local traditional public school. Public schools aren't going anywhere. So we kind of have a dual effort here in education reform. We want public schools to be as strong as possible, and we also want families to have that choice. So I think kind of we want to try to take both approaches here. And before we get to any other questions, I'll just point out that the full Apples to Apples report is available on our website. It's also linked in the chat. And we'll take a, I guess, one more look here at any questions that we might want to touch on. Of course, email us too. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, I'll just add on to what you said there. I think that's a great point. I mean, I think we, you know, we have to accept the reality that there's always some small subset of parents who won't make the effort and won't pay attention. That's a reality that that school systems do have to deal with. You know, and that's a particularly challenging subset, but we should be sober enough to realize those folks do exist. We think it's a very small percentage. You know, most parents care extensively about their kids' education, but some other parents just don't have time. You know, they're working 3 jobs and don't have time to find out about these options. I think, you know, when we talk about the barriers, I think lowering those barriers is one solution in that regard, so that parents don't have to spend as much time finding all this information, finding bills to prove they're low enough income. Even in Milwaukee, we still see some parents don't know these options exist, even with a program that's been around for 30 years. So with that, I think, you know, we recognize that it's a challenge. You know, I have a friend who is a public school teacher, and sometimes they would have to provide free food just to get parents to show up to parent-teacher conferences. So we know those things exist. We have to be sober to that reality. but we hope it's a small subset. And as much as we can lower the barriers, that can alleviate that as much as is possible. And sorry, Cory, go ahead.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that elaboration. That's very important. I think, you know, I don't want to take up too much of your time this morning. We again appreciate you all being here. We appreciate your support. Feel free to reach out to us at any time. Check out our website, our report. We're available via email as a resource and happy to discuss further with you all. So I guess with that, are there any other things here, Will, that you think we should touch on
before? No, I think we're good. And thank you all so much. And have a great rest of your day. Happy School Choice Week again.
Thank you.